Good afternoon, everyone. I'd like to welcome you all here today, our kind speakers, Pierluigi Musarò and Guglielmo Schinina. Thank you for being with us, and thank all the people who are following us on Facebook and YouTube. I know there are also members of the research team connected. First of all, the PI of the project, Professor Ruggero Eugeni. So welcome, and thank you all for being part of our second appointment of this series of webinars organized by the Università Cattolica del Sacro Cuore in the framework of the research project Migrations, Mediations on the topic of the promotion of intercultural dialogue through media, visual, and performing arts. The title of our webinar this evening is Beyond the Emergency: Media Representation, Social Encounter, and Transculturality. Before we start, let me just remind you of the research website, www.migrations-mediations.com. You'll find the link here, we will see. On the website, you'll find more information about the research project in general. And from tomorrow, the recording of this webinar will be also available, as well as you can already find the recording of our first meeting held on the 15th of April, with Angeliki Petritz, with a language officer at the European Commission, and Giuseppe Fidotta, a scholar in film and audiovisual studies, who talk about migration and circuits of film culture. We will also have a third webinar on the 19th of May, and I'll give you some details on it before saying goodbye later. Please use the chat to participate, write down your question to the speakers, and we will collect them and try to respond to as many as possible. So just a few words to introduce our guest here next to me, at least on the screen. Pierluigi is in fact in Bologna, and Guglielmo is out in the field right now, aren't you? Guglielmo yes. is connected from Nagorno-Karabakh. Am I right?
No, I'm in Yerevan today, so in the capital town of Armenia.
Okay, so always in trouble spots around the world. That's your job. And thank you so much for being here today. And let's begin with our first speaker. It's really a pleasure for me to introduce Pierluigi Musarò, who is an associate professor of sociology at the University of Bologna, where he teaches modules such as humanitarian communication and media and security. He is visiting and a research fellow at many international universities, such as the London School of Economics and Political Science. He's actually the principal investigator of an impressive number of European projects, among which, let me just mention, Atlas of Transitions, which is a Creative Europe project now in its final phase. Perceptions, a project with a very long title that I skip, and I only say that this project examines how people who have immigrated or intended to do so see Europe. It's a project funded by European Union's Horizon 2020 Research and Innovation Programme, as well as the last project I would like to mention, which is Welcoming Spaces in Europe, Revitalizing Shrinking Areas by Hosting Non-EU Migrants. Pierluigi published extensively in the field of migration, borders, human rights, media communication. Let me just mention one book among the most recent ones, to which I've also had the pleasure of contributing, so I'm particularly fond of it. The title is Right to the City, Performing Arts and Migration, that he edited with Paltrinieri, Parmigiani, Morali, and published by Franco Angeli. And let me also remember the hot of the press Italian edition of an important international book by Nico Papastergiadis, Cosmopolitanism and Culture, that Pierluigi edited and forwarded again for Franco Angeli. Last thing I am particularly happy to raise about our guest is that he is also the president of an Italian NGO, IODA, and the founding director of Itaca, a festival of responsible tourism, a very interesting initiative that has been awarded for its innovativeness, sustainability, and interculturality. With his extensive knowledge on the topic, Pierluigi will be our first speaker in dialogue with another expert that we were saying is connected from the field, who is Guglielmo Schinina. Guglielmo is the head of mental health, psychosocial response, and intercultural communication at the International Organization for Migration, IOM, the United Nations Migration Agency. IOM implements mental health psychological support programs for forcibly displaced migrants, war affected, disaster stricken population, and victims of trafficking and of all the other terrible things that happen in the world. In 2020, the organization provided programs to more than 500,000 individuals in the world and trained in related topics more than 7,000 professionals worldwide. Guglielmo is an expert in the field of social theater and community-based psychosocial support activities and processes. For 25 years, he has worked in more than 70 countries in Western and Eastern Europe, the Balkans, the Middle East, Africa, Asia, North and South America, the Pacific and the Caribbean. Most notably, he set up psychosocial support programs in Haiti, in Libya, in Nigeria, and during the Syrian crisis from 2012 onwards. He is also the author of several tools in the domain, including the recent manual on community-based MHPSS in emergency and displacement, which is at its second edition now, and papers like Migration Governance and Mental Health for the Oxford University Press Handbook of Migrant Psychiatry. He devised, directed, and taught courses and gave master's classes and workshops in several academic institutions around the world. So you can see today we have here two prominent figures, and I'm really eager to listen to them soon. But before leaving the floor to them, let me just add one thing. The title of our talk reads Beyond Emergency. What emergency are we talking about, and why and how do we try to look beyond? We talk of emergency on at least two levels in relation to migrations. The first has to do with the perception of non-migrants, of European citizens in particular. As we well know, media have an important role in influencing political attitudes and in framing public debates toward migration. In the last decade, the representation strategies and discursive practices have been presenting irregular migrants crossing borders as an emergency to be managed in terms of a wider social, cultural, and political crisis. So we are living sort of an emergency of public anxieties and security concerns, the emergency of aggressive policing and militarized border control. On the other hand, there is the migrant side of the emergency. And to understand what we are talking about when we talk about emergency affected people and communities, let's watch a couple of minutes of a first video released by IOM to clarify some key concepts connected to the mental health and psych developed in crisis. So let's play the video, please, if we can.
When wars, armed conflicts, or natural disasters like earthquakes, floods, and famine occur, communities are heavily affected. These emergencies and the migration that can result disrupt social structures and take a toll on the mental health and psychosocial well-being of individuals, families, and societies at large. To enhance and support the resilience of emergency-affected communities and protect their psychosocial well-being, it is important to build community-based mental health and psychosocial support programs that put identities, social textures, cultures and capacities of both host and displaced populations at the center of the intervention. Before going into operational models, it is important to clarify some concepts. Identity is a central concept in the psychosocial well-being of individuals and groups. Identity is a system constructed by the interrelation of at least three components: the self-concept, the cultural context, and the perception of the self by others. Identities define who you are and your relations with others, and they constantly evolve. In emergencies and displacement, however, one's feelings and behaviors, and context and culture, may be suddenly and profoundly altered, affecting one's sense of identity and psychosocial well-being. On the other side, emergencies can make one discover new sides of one's identity and new potentialities. Communities are groups who share certain commonalities, such as culture, language, values, interests, or ethnicity. Communities are composed of different subgroups or systems. Communities can create a sense of belonging and safety central to one's well-being, which can be disrupted by an emergency because of the breakdown of community structures. At times, however, communities can come closer together because of emergencies. Culture is considered to be a system of shared beliefs, behaviors, canons, rituals, values, and customs that the members of a community use to signify their world and relate with one another. Culture may offer protective, restorative, and transformative support after disruptions and promote participation, a sense of continuity, acceptance, and resilience.
Okay, thank you. Now, Pierluigi, the floor is yours.
Yes, thanks very much, Laura, and thanks also to Ruggero, Martina, and all the team at Cattolica University for inviting me. I would love to share my screen so that we can see a presentation that I have here. Okay, so can you see the presentation? Yes? Give me a feedback.
Yes, we can.
Yes, we can.
Great.
Great. So thanks very much. The idea is to have this dialogue with Guglielmo, and I'm very happy about that, about this, because I'm in a work with the University of Bologna, and usually I cross IOM and some projects during my work, but I usually try to contextualize the idea of emergency within the humanitarian field and also in the management of migration or hospitality with refugees. But in this case, I will focus more on the media representations and how can art, performative arts, foster encouraging social encounters and conviviality within our society. Why the title Beyond the Emergency? This is a title that we choose together also with Laura and Guglielmo, because I think that unfortunately when we deal with some topics such as war, conflicts, but also migration, refugees, diversity, we usually are trapped into an emergency frame. And to me, this is also the result of a gap that we have about the perception of reality. You were mentioning this European project. One of the gaps, for example, is about how many immigrants do we think that live in our countries? You know, we know how important is the idea of bordering, of creating border between us, the citizens, and them, the foreigners, the newcomers. And so we can see, for example, in this survey by Ipsos Mori, how is the gap, how big is the gap between the perception that in Italy is around 30%, in US 32%, so I mean in different countries, and reality, which means that in Italy we have only 7% of immigrants, 7% of the population, while the average of Italian people, they think, they are convinced that migrants are 30%. And this is not only in Italy. I mean, in Italy the gap is quite high, but I can even show you many other surveys in different places of the world, included Australia, that like US is one of these countries that has been made or colonized or discovered, as we usually say, by foreigners, by immigrants. But as you can see here, the feelings towards immigrants are usually negative if immigrants are not like us. So there is a sort of hierarchical ethnic preference about the others. So how do we deal with the others? And why this is important? This is important because When we talk about policies, which means law, norms, what institutions decide and govern, in this case, migration, talking about IOM, for example, that is one of these international organizations that work to manage regular ordered migration. As the director of IOM said a few years ago, that say that few areas of public policy are subject to greater misrepresentation in political discourse, but are more influenced by public opinion, like international migration. Because usually, policymakers, politicians, I mean, they don't really mind about the statistics. They mind more about the individual preferences, the public opinion, the political parties, the pressure groups, which means that usually the policy outcomes are part of this process where the gap is, this kind of trap that has an impact, has consequences on the lives of the people. And talking by the media perspective, we have to be aware about the performative force of images, discourses, narratives, images, as the one you can see here is Farage with the Brexit, how the imaginary invasion of the other is forcing us to act or react in a certain sense. And not only in UA, in UK, because the idea of visibility and invisibility of the others is part of how we shape and perceive the problem. The idea that we call it a problem is part of it, because it could be an opportunity, for example. But we usually say that is a problem, talking about migration, for example, right? Thinking about, for example, the importance of words, of how we define refugee or migrants. IOM, such as UNHCR, say that today we should talk about mixed migration flow. These are people on the move. We are talking about millions of people. But if we think about the so-called migration crisis in 2015, the Balkan route and the Mediterranean road, I was wondering about the importance of this kind of choice, because, for example, BBC say we will use only the term migrant, because these people are migrants on the move, while Al Jazeera say, wait a moment, we will use only the term refugees, because while on the move, they are asylum seekers and they come from certain countries. So they deserve the right to ask for asylum. But in this case, the battle, the conflict here is more about the imaginary, is about what we consider better or worse, if you deserve or not to be here. And here, for example, we can see that it's just an exercise, but depending on the frame, on how we represent a phenomenon, and depending on the labeling of our target, let's say migrants or asylum seekers, also the recognition rate is different. I mean, here I try to show that using emergency after the Arab Springs or during the Mare Nostrum after the two shipwrecks in Lampedusa brought to a high recognition rate, which means the compassionate frame, the pity towards people who was drawing in the Mediterranean, the poor victims. But right now, the recognition rate is kind of less of 20%. Because, of course, the frame has changed. When I say emergency, I'm talking about an imaginary. It's an imaginary of conflict, of war, could be now with the pandemic of COVID. But in this case, for example, with migrants, usually we deal with the frame that is more about the humanitarian narratives, which depict migrants as vulnerable victims, bare lives, kind of zombies because they are numbers. They don't have any identities. Culture is not there. There is no recognition. Or usually we see the securitarian narratives that focus on fear, a problem of public order, border control, repression, where migrants are invaders, are threats. Here there is a sort of kinetophobia. I mean, we scare about people in movement. Think about the Gypsy, think about the Jewish. And what we usually do is to create borders. But in this case, borders to me, it's more a process of bordering, is the spectacularization of the border, where we usually use the border in order to create a belonging or to distinguish ourselves from the others. In this case, in 2014-15, the frame was the one of the humanitarian borders. I mean, us, angels, heroes, saving them and being proud of that. But then just a couple of years ago with the same government, and still now is going on, the idea is just stop migrants. I mean, it doesn't matter if we want to stop them in Libya, to do bilateral agreement, giving money, detention center, whatever. The only important thing is to stop migrants. So we passed in a few years from the humanitarian compassion. Here you see the performative image of Aylan Kurdi on the Bodrum Bridge, the hypervisibility of this kind of suffering that was in a way just hiding the ethical and political responsibilities of our governments, to the idea of humanitarian crimes, which we have now. I mean, we are not talking about what is going on the Balkan route, in the Middle East, in Libya, because we made them invisible, where the idea is just a narrative that legitimizes the border control or the externalization of the border. How it is related with the passport, how it is related with a global order or disorder, which is also the result of a colonial or neocolonial legacy, of an imperialist past. I mean, if we see how powerful is a passport, which could be our passport or another passport from Afghanistan, Iraq, Kosovo, many different places where Guglielmo maybe go for his work, then we see that here there is a sort of mobility injustice that go well beyond the idea of the victims or the threats. Where is the problem? Here is more the focus on the narratives. Because as I told you before, there is a populist narrative on migration that is number proof. Usually for populist leader, the narrative is simple, emotional, and powerful. I mean, we are facing a barbarian invasion, and so we are the only one who will stop it, right? But we should know that it's impossible to stop migration. So migration is a normal phenomenon, is an historical one, is a state of fact. We were nomads. We were not residential as we perceive ourselves nowadays within the nation state. But in order to do something different, we need a better story and better policies. So for this reason, I will focus more in this second part on the power of art, performative art, media, culture, as a form of participation resistance. The idea is, how can we challenge this stereotyped imaginary? How can we try to encourage the encounters with the other? How can we recognize the other people as a human being and not just victims or threats? In this case, media and the arts have a long history of different experiments, different also kind of tools, of channels that we can use in order to challenge this bordering process that we do every day. I was just thinking about the power of romance novel, graphic novel, comic strips that communicate us in a creative way. What does it mean, a refugee crisis? What does it mean to move? Sometimes these kind of stories become exhibition, go into the museum, sometimes are street artwork, because art, we can see it with Banksy, with Blue. Art can be a subversive practice on the border. I mean, here we can see how this kind of murale is challenging the idea of European Union with the open borders within European Union, but as a fortress Europe outside of our borders. It's interesting, for example, another project that I came across about puppet, giant refugee puppet that worked from Syria to UK, organizing public art events, which means a travel that usually an asylum seeker is doing in a month, year. And through the puppet, the idea is to invite people to make visible this reality, to discuss, to meet, in order to challenge this kind of invisibility. And there are several projects like that. This is another Belgian collective of artists bringing these inflatable refugees in many places in the world and organizing meetings to discuss about this issue. Another project is, for example, this one in Amsterdam, but there are, again, many, many projects about that, where the idea is to use, for example, in this case, one of the boats that migrants or asylum seekers used to cross the Mediterranean. And in this case, the crew is, the crew here is people from Syria, Somalia, Eritrea, Egypt, and the Netherlands, who become touristic guide in a beautiful Amsterdam, but also telling their stories. And this is something that is very close to my interest. You, Laura, were mentioning Ithaca is the festival that tomorrow will start on migrants and travelers. We organize, for example, the migrant tour in Bologna and in other places, because when we talk about travel, we have to talk also about mobility, justice or injustice, and not only about vacation. Again, talking about the Mediterranean Sea and the way art can challenge the political imaginary. Here there is the Porta di Lampedusa by the artist Mimmo Palladino, which, as you can see, is kind of open on the Mediterranean Sea and is reminding us something that we don't usually see, the memory of the migrants who die in the Mediterranean Sea. I mean, we decide to do October 3 as the day of the memory of the migrants, but to be honest, there are no rituals about that. So we don't really remember this day of this reality. And sometimes public art can bring at the center of the political space what is going on along the borders, like Calliope Lemos, the Greek artist, did in Berlin with all the boats at the center of Europe, or like the Chinese Ai Weiwei artist did again in Berlin, recycling migrant waste. This is an interesting way to subvertize the reality, to denounce the reality. Like, for example, the list. This is a Turkish artist that is going around the world to show this list of the almost 40,000 people who died while crossing the borders. This was, for example, also a GP reading the list during the Internazionale Festival. And we can see also that in public art, there are reactions also of the people. And sometimes it could be a way to stimulate debate, to force people to talk about that, okay? Now, let me come to the final part, which is more related to the project you were mentioning, Laura, Atlas of Transition. This is a project that want to challenge this kind of separation between us and them, creating physical and symbolic spaces in order to make close people. And so what is the role of arts in this process of intercultural, transcultural participation? How can we try to create a different citizenship, which is not the citizenship of law, but is a cultural citizenship that is more related to the dimensions of belonging, of being part of a place, and to recognize a space for these people where they can act and they can perform together with us what we should call acts of citizenship. So Atlas of Transition is a three-year international project in seven countries. We put together artists, I mean curators, directors, performers, theaters, and universities. And the idea was to find together in an experimental way new ways of perceiving public spaces and cohabitation between European citizens and foreigners. The idea was to put together all this complex network and to try to do things together. Not only research, but as you can see here, festival, workshops, laboratories, summer school, performance, a web platform. So something very real in the public space to go beyond the humanitarian or securitarian frame and to challenge this way of bordering. In this case, it was interesting also to try to deborder the disciplines, not only sociologists, not only geographers, not only performers or directors, not only the public. The idea was to do an action research, transdisciplinary, where the idea was to work together with the performers, with researchers, with the public, and with the performers in order to create something different. I will give you just a few examples and then we can discuss more if you are interested. One of the actors, for example, of this project in Bologna is Cantieri Meticci, that is a company of theater that is made mainly by newcomers, by migrants and refugees. The director Pietro Floridia used the theater in public space to bring borders or discrimination at the center of the political sphere. In this case, you can see the director working with me within the university, with my class. We also worked with the performers in order to co-create the performance that was inspired by the romance Il Negro del Narciso by Joseph Conrad. And then it became a performance, a spectacle that was part of the international festival. With Zimmer Fry, which is a collective in Bologna that combines different languages, video art, sound, installation, with them we worked together in order to organize workshop dedicated to Italian and foreign adolescents. And then they created a documentary, which is like several films called Saga, where they provide an alternative view of the city of Bologna. What is interesting here is that people participate not because there are migrants or because we want to talk about migrants, but because there is a workshop, there is a laboratory, there is something to do together. And then you discover what does it mean diversity. So the festival, for example, one of the first festivals we organized in Bologna was on the topic Right to the City, and we create different kind of workshop, concert, artistic installation, DJ set, in order to invite people to reflect on cultural diversity and appropriation of urban space. I will briefly show a couple of very short videos, for example, on another artwork, which is by Muna Mussi. She's an artist in Bologna. She's from Eritrea. And for example, in this case, she creates this book that you can see in the picture, inviting many migrant women who are in Bologna to write their story on this book. And then through this sewing workshop, they created this collective creation that is a book, but was based on the encounters, the interviews, word of mouth, research. And then this book was presented within the Mambo, which is the one of the main, I will stop the screen, is one of the main museum in Bologna. And now I invite to show the two short videos where you can see the interview to one of the participants, and then one of the moments when they present this book within the cultural institution, the Museum of Modern Art, in order to see what happened there.
The situation is about me and you, okay? Everyone have his idea. We are living together, beside each other. We should be so close. And the life is like this. We should not try to fighting whose idea is the best. No, everyone is different. Everyone have his his idea, have his something beautiful in his ideas. So I think it's so nice. Yeah.
Okay, we can see the other short video where we are in the museum.
Yeah!
Okay, thanks. I just want to show a couple of very brief video. Another one is, I mean, in this case, I won't talk about that, but another one was about this director, this choreographer, Tufik. He worked, for example, on a massive collective action in public space. I mean, he proposed workshop, dance workshop, with a group made up of young foreign women, elderly people, migrants from reception centers, dancers and citizens. And it was a workshop that was made within the center of the city and in the periphery of Bologna. I just want to show you a short video of 1 minute. Okay, and then to conclude, I mean, there are many more materials, but I think that here the idea is just to understand that through the workshop, through the festival, the idea was to challenge what we usually give for granted. I mean, this kind of separation between us and them, and to create this space of encounter. For example, just the last two projects I want to mention, we create with the Cuban activist Tania Bruguera, a referendum which was about should we abolish our borders, and we create not only many places in the city with signs where people can go and vote, and 4,000 people voted. It has not a juridical meaning, but it was more a symbolic one. But we organized many moments where to discuss with people, where to engage people, to create a sort of audience engagement, audience development. As we also created this school of integration, where in the festival home with Tania Bruguera, we gave a space to the ethnic community present in Bologna to do for 1 hour what they want, which means that the Ukrainian women invite people to paint the eggs, or the Chinese people invited to sing for the karaoke, or, I mean, it was not us representing them, but was creating a space where different people, different identities can meet and do something different. Also, we organized the summer school. And just to finish, I think this kind of project show that there are ways to reshape the public space, also in a physical and symbolic way, where you can deal with social inequalities in an innovative way. You can try to challenge to the border the narratives, promoting inclusion, recognition, giving voice beyond the xenophobic rhetoric or the frame of emergency, to establish relationship. Many people participating in this workshop, they became friends. They went beyond the fear that we have towards the diversity. And finally, I think it's important because this kind of aesthetic cosmopolitanism in a way can also encourage the idea of enlarging the idea of citizenship, which is, as Hannah Arendt say, the right to have rights. So I just hope to have given you a very brief overview on this project, and then I'm happy to discuss with Guglielmo and you all after his presentation. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you, Pierluigi. Your presentation was really rich and wide-ranging. I think you have maybe a little shocked us all with your comment, making us realize the distance between the image we generally have of the emergency and its real dimensions and the impact that this populist narrative, as you call it, has on us. So it's really powerful, this narrative, and we don't realize it really so often, so clearly usually. But I think you've also opened up some prospects of hope with the amazing project that you have presented, and all these people, cheerful people, so colorful, and I think that these realities can show that our path towards integration and against populist narrative is possible and is progressing, I would say. So thank you so much. And now I'd like to turn it over to Guglielmo Schinina. So what are your thoughts, Guglielmo?
You can hear me. I hope you can hear me because I have some problems. Okay, perfect. I don't have a presentation. Actually, mine won't be a presentation. It's more a reaction, you know, to what Pierluigi has presented so far, you know. And I wanted to start point by point, you know, a reaction to all these points, you know. The first issue is the definition of migrant, or migrant versus refugee. I think, you know, that more and more the word migrant, that in fact in any dictionary means simply, you know, the person that is moving from one place to another, from the place of birth, of the place of usual residence to another, is assuming new meaning. That in Europe especially, because then we usually the discourse on migration, also the criticism on the discourse on migration is quite Eurocentric in general, you know, from our side. But in Europe, at least, it's more connected in derogatory terms now with issues of race, skin color, social class, you know, to the extent that words started to be used differently. So you mentioned before, you know, the refugee crisis, you know, of the Syrian refugee crisis, for instance, was called almost universally a migrant crisis, yet those were, in legalistic terms, refugees. On the other side, migrants are now usually considered those that come, you know, from a different cultural environment, and they are of a different skin color. This is based on quite clear in the European context, where the European Union don't consider migrants people who move inside the territory. So, based on, I'm Italian, I live in Belgium, I'm not a migrant, you know, for the European Union. On the other side, new terms are being created to differentiate, let's say, the rich, beautiful, you know, and somehow non-vulnerable migrants from the others. Now there is the new term of expatriate. What is an expatriate? Expatriate is a migrant who has a job, and yet this is a new terminology. So there is a risk, you know, with the new attribution that are projected on the term migration, and that's why then somehow UNHCR at a certain point said please don't assimilate migrants and refugees, because otherwise the migrants will pay the negative connotation that is attributed to the word. So this is my first reaction, and I think, you know, we cannot really start all this discussion if you don't consider the issue of race, the issue of racism, the issue of skin color, and the issue of cultural power dynamics and the issue of social status, so rich versus not rich, otherwise you know, it becomes a complicated discussion. The other issue is I wanted to bring to the table is the one of who is a migrant and who is a refugee. We started with a video that probably might be a bit misleading because linked migration directly with emergency. In reality, that's not for most migrants. You know, in the world, most migrants move for other reasons that have to do with better life prospects, studies abroad, better jobs, income, and so on. You know, so consider the refugee migrant, if you want to use this term. So the proportion between those who escape from wars or persecution and those who move because they think, you know, they can have a better life elsewhere is 8 to 92%. So most people move actually for other reasons. And they don't move from places in war and places in disaster or, you know, in very, very vulnerable situation. Usually most migration happen from mid-income countries to high-income countries. You know, that's what happens. Another issue that I wanted to, sorry, I'm using the word issue quite a lot, but never mind. So the other argument that I wanted to make is that there is not only one narration about migration. So we spoke so far about the populist sovereignist narration that is very more narrative or, you know, also discourse that is very much embedded in the concept of nation state, in a probably misinterpreted concept of nation state, in which migrants had already from the very beginning a strong role to play. This concept was a product, you know, of a certain cultural environment, the European cultural environment of the second part of the 18th century, and this is and also, you know, in the first part of the 18th, and this is where basically the suffering of the migrants who were living in Paris, that was the center of that culture, you know, at the time. I want to, you know, consider Chopin, for instance, you know, and all those. So the suffering, the trauma was used as a way to reinforce the discourse on the national state, paradoxically. You know? These were people suffering because they were far from a country, and therefore, you know, they were brought at the center of the communication of the time, of the artistic communication of the time, exactly to reinforce what was a political objective of the time. However, there is not only this narration. This narration is the sovereignist populist narration, is the one that is built on the fact that we have a strong identity. Our strong identity is built on our concept on state and nation and the fact that we have borders. And the presence or the arrival of people who, especially the ones who don't follow the rules to arrive, create a scenario in which our identity is threatened, you know, and we should protect. However, there is another narrative that I think is equally really, no? Even though its outcomes might be better, but equally on the long term dangerous. That is the one that in Italy is called buonista, or the humanitarian approach to migration, the one that consider all migrants who arrive victims of an emergency, victim of something, or someone that is intrinsically vulnerable. And therefore, we need to help them. We need to host them because they are vulnerable. This has created as many problems as the other narrative. Because while it's true that probably no, you will save boats in the Mediterranean Sea if you have this narrative rather than not doing it, which is already better. However, you still objectify. So both narratives are part of a discourse, or a general discourse that objectify migrants. Migrants are not humans that move for a variety of reasons, a variety of situations from their country to another, but become an object, a political object, a social object, a object of threat, you know, and fear, but also a object of assistance. Also in situations where maybe this assistance is superfluous. This is very related with what Vanessa Pubavac called the risk management approach to politics in general. No? What she says is basically that in the last decades, politics are not considered anymore as a space for participation, but as a space for delegation. She's talking obviously about the democracy, the big democracy in the world. And delegation were once elected, the politician has a delegated power that consists mainly in the work of a mega social worker, the one to identify where risks are and respond to these risks, you know, so prevent these risks to happen. Obviously, the identification of this risk is not a neutral product, because these are not scientists, are politics or are politicians. So it is very often then biased by vested interest or ideological presumptions. And we go back to the populist narrative, but also the humanistic narrative, humane narrative about migration. So that they are all victims, or they are all terrorists, you know, or they are here to destroy our society. They are basically almost non-humans, and we have to help them, because that's, you know, what is necessary. This risk management approach, any risk management approach, bring two categorizations. So you don't have any more humans that come, you know, to your shores, but you have at your airport, you know, to your stations, but you have categories. And when you start categorizing phenomenon, which is a necessary, no, necessary element of management, obviously, you end up creating disaster. That's not creating a new culture. This is actually fragmenting groups and cultures in forms that are readable for the host culture, and therefore banalize the entire experience. And I think this is quite interesting, because in this new situation, vulnerability becomes then the passport, not the wild card, to be accepted. So this we see it in any policy. You know, the idea is that if I'm vulnerable, if I can prove that I'm a refugee, if I can prove that I'm traumatized, I'm allowed to stay. If I cannot do that, even though I'm productive, you know, I'm very motivated, I would like to stay in the country, I'm not. No, I have to leave. I have to go back. And this is obviously a result of the risk management approach, where, you know, individual become interesting only when they are intrinsically vulnerable, or there is a projection of vulnerability on them, or they can bring vulnerability to us, and therefore can become a subject of a political discourse that use them to reinforce. And then I want to reinforce what? And I want to go to the last point, an identity that is in crisis. Because when we talk about emergency and crisis of identity, it's true that probably migration is an emergency. But it's true that probably is an emergency for us more than we think. So it's not the migrant that come that put us in a crisis, but it's the fact that the migrant that come show and our approach to what is happening show the crisis in which we are, an identity crisis, a value crisis, a political crisis. And therefore, you know, we need an external object on which to project our limits, upcoming limits as a society, in order to be able to pretend to survive a society in the way they were constructed. In this sense, you know, then we create a lot of spaces, you know, spaces of thresholds, no? Spaces where, as Foucault was saying, you know, what is the objectification, you know, he was saying, you objectify people, putting them through tests, you know, and the main test is the one of proving their own identity. And that's exactly what happens to migrants wherever shore, you know, you put them in these spaces that are in themselves spaces of vulnerability, that require and create vulnerability, like identification center, transit centers, and so on and so forth, in order for them to prove their identity, so that they can be part of us. But their identity is not their real identity. It is, again, what they have to prove is their identity as vulnerable individual that can be then accepted in our society. I think this is what is happening, you know, and I think it's quite, for us, you know, for me especially, no, very, very concerning. Someone spoke before about Alan Kurdi. I mean, Pierluigi actually did, but also other scholars, you know, in Italy have done it. Fausto Colombo wrote a very interesting book about that. I think Alan Kurdi was, interestingly, at that time, the only migrant in the migration, the only refugee, in fact, that was a child refugee in reality, no? But it was the only migrant in that so-called migrant crisis that received individual attention. And that refugee was actually the dead corpse of a toddler. No, and I think that's that was for many of us in terms of communication a determining moment, because what he showed, what made the person interesting for us, was that that's the death that is unacceptable. The death of a child is something that doesn't exist as a possibility in any culture. As you probably know, in any culture there is a word to define the child who lose the father or the mother, or you know, the husband who lose the wife, and vice versa, and so on and so forth. And there is no word, you know, to describe or to define the mother or the father who lose the child. That's the big taboo, the big object. So it's exactly one of the things on which we constructed our concept of nation state, especially in the revolution, then, you know, the 19th and 20th century. So the fact that there are some things that we exclude from our society: poverty, war, disasters, the death of children, exactly. So Alan Kurdi showed us this image, why it was so popular, because he showed us our own limits as a society. So this death, you know, at the shores of Europe, of a toddler, showed us that, in fact, you know, even though this is an object for us, it's an object that we are projecting somewhere else, you know, before of us and during the travel, that the horrors that we have tried to eliminate from our society persist somewhere else, are created for the most part by us, and they can come back to us, you know, at a certain point. And that's why probably there was also the need to beautify that image, you know, in many different memes and things, which is a reappropriation, a cultural reappropriation. To me, very unethical, you know, in this sense, you know, because it responds again to a need of the receiving culture, to that narrative that is presumably more humane, but that basically lives out of the extreme vulnerability and the extreme, I don't know to say, objectification, exactly, no, of migration. This is what I think is happening, you know, in terms of connected political and media discourse and public opinion discourse, which I think are strictly linked. What is then the role of art, you know, and play? For me, obviously, when I speak about art, I speak about all of those activities that are connected with performance, you know, and for me, that is a wider spectrum that include exactly, you know, performances, include, you know, theater, include the other forms of art, but include also sociocultural activities that community usually do spontaneously by themselves, or include rituals and celebrations, you know, can include also play and various forms of play. And I think this is important because I think that performance doesn't mean the same thing to all the cultures, you know. And this is something that we have to consider, as well as culture as different meanings, you know, in different society, or at least how culture is becoming a product, you know. So the process of producing culture can be somehow relatable, but what are the interesting or necessary cultural products, you know, to define that gesture and that act as something that signify in the wider culture is obviously something different. So what is my first comment? No, I have a more negative view than the one of Pierluigi on the actual significance, you know, of these activities. And in fact, you know, this is also a dramatic resolution for me, since I spent all my life, basically, you know, most of my life, trying to promote the value of culture, you know, in bringing people together. You know, to be very simple. And I think, you know, the before I saw Chantal Mouffe, you know, that was quoted many years ago at the Free University of Berlin, I had the honor, you know, to share a keynote speech with Chantal Mouffe. It was me and her, you know, speaking, and we ended up talking about a very interesting work of performance and visual art. It was the Gramsci Mausoleum built by Thomas Hirschhorn in one of the infamous yards, you know, or courtyards of the Bronx, you know, in New York. So he decided to create, with very poor materials, a sort of museum mausoleum for Gramsci, with memorabilia of Gramsci, but also messaging from Gramsci, and a lot of activities happening there all the day, culturally related, of cultural animation, if you want, in one of the most depleted, you know, areas of New York. That was inhabited for the 95% by African American. I went, obviously, you know, immediately, as soon as I could, you know, to visit the mausoleum. Chantal Mousse was one of the inspirers, you know, of the mausoleum itself. And when I went there, you know, it was quite interesting to see that there was this group of white people like me that came from all over the world to go to the Bronx and see this mausoleum that was totally ignored by all the African American around, no, that were living in that same courtyard. Actually, they were reacting against it, you know, because, you know, they were wondering why this was happening. So what I wanted to say is this, you know, it's important, you know, as Mao Zedong was saying, you know, let 100 flowers bloom, and these flowers might make a plantation, but when there is a desert around, you know, this might be difficult. And for me, the point is that all these activities bring some risks. One is to, and I see it all the time, you know, there are a lot of activities that try to play on the vulnerability factors. So basically, the stories of the migrant become interesting only when the migrant is suffering. You know? So this extreme experience of suffering that become beautiful, probably to listen at. Maybe they move the people who listen to them, but then, you know, they reinforce this idea of migration as vulnerability that, in fact, build on the objectification of migration. Then the other risk is the one that I saw very often creating events, creating spaces where the body-to-body functions, and we know that by experience that when we do an action together with another person, this action has a symbolic nature, you know, no matter what is our cultural diverse cultural background, we create a space of exchange, we create a space of solidarity. And yet, these spaces become like the island of Barba's Theater, you know, in the 70s and 80s, that were very interesting in themselves, but they weren't able to dialogue anymore, you know, with the society and what the society was becoming. So, yes, you know, this flower might bloom, but what are we doing so that these flowers can actually bloom and can keep on receiving water, you know? And that's a bit one of my big concerns. The other one is the use of performance almost as a validation of the spaces I was talking to, no? The fact that ghettos exist in town, the fact that identification center exists, you know, that there are hotspots that are in fact, you know, detention-like situation, that migrants are detained for purely administrative reason against all international concept of what is that detention, are unacceptable, you know, events. Those are not space where culture or art can be done. And in fact, we often don't understand that, and me for first, you know, and we go to these spaces trying to do what we can to entertain people, to make people resilient, to give them an agency that, however, is fictitious because they cannot change the general discourse that is the one of political and administrative management of migration towards which they don't have much, they cannot do much. So this is what I wanted to say. So just to summarize, you know, that migration is now related with issues of class, social class, you know, and color, you know, it's not anymore, and race, you know, it's not anymore what it was before. Even the same word is now used only for certain categories of migrants, not others. That there is a risk management approach to politics that brings to an objectification of migrants, because migration is part of this risk management approach. And migrants become risks based also on assumptions, based on ideological interest, and based also on false information, or maybe even lobby, no, political and interest lobby. That the narrations are two and not one. There is not only the sovereign populist, there is also the one that wants to see migrants as victims and vulnerable people to help, that is reaching also the highest political level. The Global Compact on Refugee and Migration insists quite a lot, you know, on the issues of vulnerability vis-à-vis the one of development that migration bring with it. That is, when you start objectifying, you start also putting threshold, you start asking people to identify, and this pass through a very concrete element of further objectification that in the case of migration somehow in the last years also have to do with vulnerability. You have to have a vulnerable identity in order to be part, because otherwise you're not. Or by contrast, you can be the superhero, the ones that, you know, save the child, you know, in the river or whatever, and therefore, you know, you are good enough, you know, to be part of us. But most of the narration is, and the legal administrative narration is, you can be part of us if you are vulnerable enough, if you suffered enough to be here. That maybe have also to do with the Catholic, you know, idea of culture of the countries that are the ones that bring this meaning, you know, with them. These treasures are, as I said, you know, extremely dangerous. And therefore, what are the risks of making culture, you know, or trying to make cultural product as we believe they are, you know, in these situations, as Chantal Mouffe and I had to realize, you know, some years ago, the fact that you might create cultural products that mean only for you and not for, no, for them. So that's, you know, that's one risk. The second is to validate certain spaces of separation and vulnerability because they are of artistic or social artistic relevance, but in fact you don't change the objective conditions in all these spaces. You are not able to reach that level. The fact of creating experiences that are significant, you know, in the body to body, but become socially and politically insignificant as soon as you exit from this group, unless you work on accumulation, but the accumulation of internet and the media is obviously, no, an accumulation that is much more fast and much more ready to arrive. The other, and with this I would conclude, is en masse, you know, so these studies have been hunting me for many years, you know. En masse is a linguistic professor that many years ago studied how you create the out-group, you know, the creation of in-groups and out-groups. And she started from a very funny example. There were football football fans, you know, in Milan, because she studied many in Italy. And the people that were part of the different contradas in Siena, no, for the Siena horse race. And she came to something quite clear, you know, that whenever one in-group and out-group are created, and now it seems that the out-group migrants, you know, this homungus, you know, group of people, is an out-group, actually, you know, for many people. And it's an out-group that has to do, as I said, you know, with objective physical characteristic even, you know, and social characteristic, not really with the fact of moving, you know, from one place to another. Basically, this out-group usually is created in a way that even if you put positive image of the person from the out-group, you won't achieve much, because that positive characteristic are attributed to the individual, not to the group. While by contrary, when there is something very negative that regards one member of this group, that is attributed to the entire group, which is the opposite for the in-group. You know, for the in-group, you will generalize the positive behavior, you know, of one element, and you will actually attribute the negative only to one. So this is also something that we have to consider. Many often we spend also, you know, in our organization a lot of resources, money, energies to portray a positive image of migrations. And therefore, you know, the result that you bring is the fact that people will think, okay, that migrant is okay, that migrant is worth staying here. But they don't generalize it to the category of migrant. And with this I conclude, because the category of migrant is basically almost a ghost of the abject that we try to exclude from our society, and is coming back, you know, to us in different forms. All the bad that we have done is returning in physical forms of vulnerabilities.
Thank you, Guglielmo, for your precious, passionate words, all your insight, and the challenging suggestion, I would say. You showed out the other side of the coin, we may say, the risk also of the humanitarian speech and narrative that objectify the migrants and does not respect their identity, dignity. And also some of the comments of our audience underlined this fact. For example, I read something, Linda underlined the fact that we have to call not migrant, not refugees, they are in first place people, and as people they have power. The idea also is to Mona Lisa suggests that we have to overcome the we-they framework, engaging them in design thinking and co-designing processes to craft new systemic approaches together. So absolutely, the idea that we have to dialogue, and I would like to underline that in our title, for example, we used an important keyword, I would say transculturality, suggesting the idea that we can become something new altogether, not just dialogue between different identities, or integrate or does not accept people coming from abroad, but can become a new, different world, putting under facing the change that comes not just from people coming from abroad, but from ourselves. As you were saying, the identity, our identity, is something we have to reconsider together with all the people living with us and coming from wherever they come. A couple of question one and many comments and also compliments. Mona Lisa was asking also, are these projects still ongoing some way during the pandemic? How can be of any help? And another question that we are running a bit out of time, so I try to read more than one question in one. Many of the people involved could have a different meaning of performing in their original culture. How the cultural integration continues after the performing workshops. Performing is moving. Moving is facilitating transition. So, couple of words, Pierluigi, what do you think?
Yeah, thanks very much. Yeah, and really I agree with the analysis also by Guglielmo, although I'm not so pessimistic. Maybe I'm not on the ground like you. But I totally agree with the analysis, and I mean, just these two questions. No, the project is not still ongoing, just because with the pandemic we were forced to do some activities like the summer school online. But at the same time, I think that yes, this idea of performing and transitions, but I would say translation, is quite interesting, because working with different people, even different, partners within the project, was interesting. What was intended as a performance, because for me as a sociologist, is a linguistic act, is the performative force of images, of narratives, while for the directors of the theaters or for a performers, the performance is a completely different meaning. And then, of course, and we are part of the same culture. I mean, like Italians or Europeans. Of course, when we go in relationship with other culture, we have to challenge this and to work together to find a common glossary. I think it's interesting because this is part also of the narratives and the way we focus the different categories. To be honest, I believed it was easier to work together in a transdisciplinary way, but at the end, I have to say that has been very, very difficult, because we have different imaginaries, tools, skills, and sometimes methodologies that we use while we want to do the same thing, which is, for example, create this kind of space. Let me just say about the categories that I think we are part of it, because, Guglielmo was mentioning there is a big difference between migrant and expats. But then, for example, there is a difference also with tourists. And within migration, there is a difference with refugees. But I mean, these are kind of normative, statistical, fiscal categories sometimes. Until a few years ago, there were no such categories. it was part of the nation state deciding to naming, which means also dominating, control the movement of people. But in the case, for example, of having pity of the vulnerability, I think that it has something to do with the idea of right, right? Because if we focus vulnerability, and sometimes we are part of it, as you say, the same NGOs, if you see like the traditional Save the Children advertisement, Adopt a Child, is about vulnerability. And so even here, asylum has to be intended not as a human right, but as a gift. People, they need to deserve to show, they have to be the good boy, they have to fit into our frame of being a good Samaritan. And so again, the suffering here is at the center. But just to close, I think that this idea of the ghost or even the scapegoat is functional for the group, for the identity of the group, because it reinforces the inner group. But my hope is that these islands that Guglielmo say, that we create islands, but many islands can be archipelags. And some archipelags can create something new, or, I mean, you can create different territories like archipelags, and they are divided, like the Israelians with the Palestinians, when we talk about islands and archipelags. Or this is just my hope, that creating these archipelags, the new generation, I think the children, just because I have a little boy who go to the maternity school, and so for him, for example, the idea of skin colors is just a way to distinguish different students, different children, but sharing the daily life, I hope it not become another category, but it's just part of diversity with people with whom you share the daily life. But it's just a hope. So I'm optimistic, and I don't know if it'll be like that.
Guglielmo?
Io volevo rispondere a una domanda sulla come si fa a valutare questo tipo di attività, no? In yes. realtà volevo mostrare un video, poi mi sono fatto prendere un po' la mano e quindi non l'abbiamo fatto.
In Italian?
Sorry.
Switch. Just went for the song. We are much more at ease, but it's a bit strange. Okay, so the question, because our audience can't read in the, I don't think that everybody can see, the question is, which indicators of success or tools could be useful to assess the impact of the project and activities you have analyzed? That's the
exactly. So basically, what I was saying is that we wanted to show a video. No, I wasn't able because I was taken by by this course. But in the link that you see in the chat, there is a manual, you know, and there is a chapter of this manual. I think it's chapter 11 that is on evaluation of this kind of programs, you know. Why that, you know, because obviously working for a big international organization that receive funds, you know, from donors, you need to bring results, you know. And so we created a framework that, however, is based on the fact of constructing the indicators together with the communities with which you work, you know? And I think can be, you know, interesting, you know, for many of your programs, you know, even small scale program, you know, if you are doing like that, it's not perfect, but look at the way in which you can bring actual results. However, not forgetting that the indicators should be indicators of well-being or social cohesiveness and so on, need to be created together with the people that you are working with, you know, because otherwise are again another attribution. And so you have the link and the chapter, honestly, I don't remember now the number of the chapter. I think I have 11 or 14, is about how you monitor and evaluate activities, artistic and creative activities in this context.
Okay, we will put the link also in the Migration Mediation website, so that will be easy. Pierluigi, would you like to add something on this theme of evaluation? then we have.
Yes, I think that it's very, I mean, during these 3 years of the project, it was difficult because from the European Union to public debate, there is always the problem of how can you evaluate, how can you measure this kind of social impact. Of course, it will be in the near future. You cannot evaluate through a survey in the moment. But again, here, the hope is that you seed something that in the near future will give life to something different. And I don't know if there is the, also another question here about NGO, like the children have the right to make
questions.
Yeah, I mean, maybe Guglielmo can answer better than me, but teaching humanitarian communication, I usually use Save the Children advertisement in order to criticize this kind of humanitarian rhetoric that dehumanize people, and it's useful. Then when you interview these people, they say it works. But what does it mean? It works that they do more fundraising, they raise more funds. But to me, the problem is not raising more money, although I understand that to work in this kind of NGOs is one of the main aims.
Yeah, I'm not in a position to criticize, you know, our partners, obviously. You know, I cannot do that, and I don't want to do that. But I think, you know, that a very interesting, I think, you know, reading about humanitarian communication is Boltanski, you know, and what he says, you know, about the use of suffering. I mean, for me, there have been always in my work, since I work also on social communication, you know, with my projects, two big points of reference. One is Boltanski, and the other one is Susan Sontag, you know. The two books are Regarding the Pain of the Others, or The Pain of the Others, I don't remember, you know, the titles in which edition, and Boltanski about humanitarian communication. I think, you know, what is in those book is quite clear, you know, says that the fact that you, any image is a selection, so you are bringing a part of the reality, no? If you want to bring the suffering, it's the suffering, but also, you know, the resilience of these people, it could be an equally interesting, you know, element. And the other, so you are making a choice whenever, you know, you present an image. And the choice has implications that are political and also in terms of communication as well. And the other issue I think that is quite important is the fact that when you emphasize too much the suffering becomes, let's say, you anesthetize people, you know, towards the suffering. So basically, you know, we spoke before about Alan Kurdi, you know, that was an image that gave, you know, made an incredible impression. There are other children dying, you know, we have seen these images, you know, lately. Not only they are not somehow provoking the universal, you know, reaction that that image provoked, but in fact somehow they are even mocked now, no, on social media, no, they start saying, no, those are fake images and so on and so forth. So basically emphasizing only one aspect of the reality of people brings to the understanding of all these phenomena, so only phenomena of suffering, and on the other, which is not positive, I think, and on the other side, it creates an environment where you anesthetize people to suffering. So they are not, that's not sexy or interesting anymore after a while. However, it's true that especially in the digital era, pushing, you know, so an image of the sort make you push the $5 button, you know, when you want, when you have to make these quick forms of fundraising. WFP, who at the same time won the Nobel Prize, has done a lot of this communication as of late, you know, with the starving children in Yemen or things of the sort.
Oh, thank you. Thank you for your challenging and also inspiring words. It's getting late, so I think I have to take just 1 minute to warmly thank you. Thank our speaker, the organizing committee, all the people who have been connected. Thanks for watching and participating. Let me just remind you of our last appointment on the 19th of May. Maybe we can show the, so we will have the third webinar. The title is We Tell a Different Story, the Role of Documentary Film, Alternative and Community Media in Reporting Migration. There will be little number of speakers, and Nadia Bellardi as moderator with Alice Cati. So thank you all. See you next time, and bye.